to talk about OmniDB, a GUI, a web-based application to use Postgres with. So how many folks, is everyone a Postgres user today? You guys prefer using a GUI rather than the command line? Any preference? Or how about other databases? Do you guys have to use other databases now, like Oracle or SQL Server, DB2, MySQL, all of the above, or some variation of all those things? So with, I guess, any graphical user interface, it's hoping to make some things easier for folks. And this is just one alternative, other ones that you may heard of. Now, I actually feel kind of bad. I always have trouble remembering the pay-for ones, even though I'll recognize them when I hear people talk about them. But pgAdmin is another one. PHP, whatever the PHP one is. Sorry, I actually have trouble remembering the name of that one too. But some of these you may have run into over the years. So omnidb.org is the website. So maybe I have a nice slide, I think, but it's a web-based application. It can be run in a standalone mode if you didn't just wanted to run it on your laptop or whatnot, but it could also be set up on some centralized server in your network, so you can access whatever systems you have in your infrastructure. It is meant to try to be a user, well, not user, single, have everything that you need to right in front of you. We'll take a look and you can decide for yourself if it has everything that you need. Easy ways to add or remove databases you want to connect to. Also try to be cognizant of security aspects such as encrypting people's passwords and login information and trying not to let that kind of stuff sit in memory for too long. So like needing to timing out sessions if people are getting up from their desk and who knows how long they're going to be gone. Trying to make it simpler to edit information in your database. I'm just trying to make everything easier for you with GUI if you need that sort of a tool. So a little bit of history. OmniDB started out originally as a C#.NET application that supported a whole bunch of stuff, including Postgres. As of version 2, it was rewritten as a Django app, initially for Postgres. Second Quadrant, as a company, got involved and looked to support another web-based app. So Second Quadrant actually hired these guys and encouraged them to do a rewrite into Django, start off with Postgres support, and have been slowly adding back some of the other databases, such as Oracle, MySQL, and RareDB. So as Postgres users, I'm curious, are folks using anything like Postgres XL2 or any of the PGLogical or BDR stuff, right? So I won't spend too much time on that. These are different extensions of features that Postgres can do for multi-master support or logical replication or distributed database. So as these things aren't necessarily built in, a lot of other, fairly sure that some of the other GUIs, graphical user interfaces that work with Postgres aren't going to tend to not work with too many add-on extensions. So if you do find yourself later on down the road, OmniDB can help with some of the administrative stuff through the GUI to set up replication and so on with some of these extensions. And OmniDB is used, is released under the MIT license. For those of you that is important, what kind of licensing is used with software and so forth. It does run on, if you were to run it on your local system, yeah, it does run on Linux and Mac OS and Windows. So what I was planning on doing, if you don't have to feel like you need to follow along, I was gonna go through screenshots of OmniDB, go through screenshots of some of the more basic operation stuff, and then I can try to show some live demo of some of the other things, just because some screenshots can't capture everything that are interesting to see. So most flavors, most of the popular flavors of Linux. And Windows, Mac OS, for those of you who are comfortable with Python, it's hopefully straightforward to set up a virtual environment and install those packages that you need and run it from within a virtual environment. Just a little architecture background. I think I was kind of verbally saying this. You got your infrastructure. However many database servers up here, you can set up a standalone system to host the Django app and let users connect to it with their whatever browser they feel comfortable with. Security is always a growing thing. Just to reassure folks that people's browsers can connect to OmniDB over HTTPS. You can set up authentication for users to connect to the OmniDB app in addition to whatever additional authentication that you want to have between OmniDB and the databases it connects to. Some folks have been concerned, so we want to make notes of letting folks know that you can have sessions timeout. So, in addition to those cases where people get up for unexpectedly for unknown amount of time, you can also set up pgpass files or a pgservice.com file for those of you familiar setting up, what's the word I'm looking for, not aliases, but basically configuration files for user password for database and whatnot. So I'll go over some of the screenshots of some of the basic features. You can set up multiple database connections. You can save the connection info, what kind of database you're connecting to, where the IP address, port, user, database name. Give it some kind of alias for the tabs when you pop up if you want to. Give it some maybe more human readable name. You can have then multiple tabs open, you can have multiple connections open simultaneously to different systems, which will be represented by different tabs. I think a common tree view where you have your database that you're connected to. I think this cuts off some things. The instance that you're connected to with Postgres. Then you'll have your list of the databases within that instance. Then within each database, whatever schemas that you have defined, the tables in that schema. Then within the tables, it'll give you details on the columns and what the primary keys are. You can see what the primary keys are defined. And some of these is this is kind of hinting at then with each individual object, depending on what it is, there could be additional submenus for editing, adding, removing, well, whatever modification stuff that you want to do. There's an interface for creating and modifying tables. So once you have a table created, you can have different tabs open for the table that you work with. It'll show the columns, what the data types are, various constraints, like whether it's nullable or not. And within the same interface, you can change the data types and whatnot. And of course, if you're used to doing these sort of operations before, you still do need to work with the considerations of like changing a text field to an integer and so forth. Then within a table, if you can look at the data of the table, represented pretty similar to what a spreadsheet looks like. Not just in addition to looking at the whole table, you could also specify a query to look at a subset of the data in the table. Then from the data that's returned, should see more lines. It doesn't look like a spreadsheet, so then you can start editing the individual cells of the table. And then I think
it's interesting because it shows up on that one.
Oh, it should be standing over the other projector. Yeah. And then the colors are much better too, aren't they?
Yeah, it's a little dimmer, but it's definitely showing more.
Maybe one of the bulbs need to be updated in that. So yeah, it shows up like a table. I've forgotten what the colors mean, but you can edit the data in there and then hit a button to just save all the changes at once, which may be important for those of you familiar with the nuances of committing and rolling back data. These cells don't update as soon as you're done updating. You've got to remember to tell it to save those changes for you. So with some of the query interfaces, sorry, I already forgot. Are folks familiar with using the PSQL command line interface? I have some experience, comfort level with that. So the web interface tries to have some of the niceties that the PSQL command line gives you. So for example, did you guys know that even in PSQL you can tab complete things and when you're writing statements, like you write a select, you could hit tab complete for, well, and it kind of depends on where you are in the query to help you pick column names and so forth. So same thing in the web interface of OmniDB. You could start writing whatever queries. So in this example here that's showing, in the middle of the from clause where you're specifying your other tables to join against, it'll start. This is already on the table. This will help you do an autocomplete on column names. Another thing about the user interface, it'll also keep a history. There will be, so this is after hitting the button to show you what your history is, but it'll show you when you started to run a previous statement, how long it took, in addition to whether or not that query completed successfully or not. Maybe that's the best way to put it, but for example, if you had a syntax error, looks like using those meta commands in PSQL. So, and if you didn't know, some of these meta commands with the slash whatever to do things like list your tables, list your sequences, describe what the details of a table are. These meta commands are actually a PSQL special. And what OmniDB has done is re-implemented some of them. So for folks familiar with the command line, some of these things are available exactly the same way as they are in some of these things are available in OmniDB as they are in the command line, in the PSQL command line. So now for some other things that you really can't get in the command line utility. OmniDB provides a bunch of visualizations where you can look at different health aspects and some performance aspects that you just can't do with command line utility. I've only shown this one screenshot. I thought this was one of the things that would be nice to just show on a live or anything. But just to give you an idea, there is a tab that you can open up, a monitoring tab that you can open up. This screenshot is just showing what the size of a database is. So this one is running, it's showing that it's running every 30 seconds just to see what the size of the database is, and then I'll plot that as a line graph. Just to verbally mention to what extent that this can show you, you could do things like the number of locks. OmniDB also has a facility such that you could, if you were to set it up, you could SSH onto the database system that you wanted to monitor, such that you can pull system information, such as the processor utilization. In addition to these other things, which would simply just need to query the database for, like the number of logs, what the replication status is. And it can represent that as line charts, pie charts, or a bar chart. So I'm sure there'll be some time that we can see some of those things, which will be, I think, a little more interesting than seeing screenshots on. A couple other things that you might be able to visualize, or well, that you can visualize that you wouldn't be able to otherwise with the command line utility is you could get a graph, create a graph of the relationship between tables. So in this particular example, this is looking at a database where you have a table of sailors, a table of boats. Using ER terminology, those would be the entities. You have a relationship table that is showing the relationship between the sailors and the boats table. This particular graph is also showing all of the attributes of each of the tables. So the sailor tables really only has these four columns in it of an ID, name, rating, age, and what their data types are. This is also interactive too. You can move these things around and print it out and save it and whatnot if you were also looking for something to do that graphing for you. So you can print out. And how many folks like looking at query plans? Have you guys a little bit? Yeah. So you can also use OmniDB to do an explain analyze, depending on what the case may be. This example is showing explain analyze. The text, if you ignore the colors, the for a moment, the text here is showing you exactly what the command line interface would show you, what the planning time is, what the execution time is, the number of rows retrieved, the join methods and whatnot. So now what these colors are showing is a relative and visual representation of the execution time. So in this bottom red bar, doing the sequential scan of 0.004 milliseconds, and there's this other sequential scan up here that doesn't quite take us along. This is, am I reading these? This is even hard for me to read on these whiteboards up here. But so it's showing these bars of how long the execution time has taken. And if you're not familiar with the way the execution plans, the timing and the execution plans work, as you move up the tree, it's showing you the cumulative time. So they've colored this such that these two sequential scans are going to be bottom leaf nodes. This one at the top is a nested loop join. And what the light red bar is showing you is what the cumulative time is at that part in the plan. And the darker part is showing you what the actual time of that particular step is. So some of these things are intended to help see where the time is on some of these execution plans. Otherwise, if you're familiar with other websites like, I always forget how to pronounce his name, Deepez, there's an explain site where you could take this text, paste it into that, and it would do a similar thing, give you some colorized visualization of how the performance of query plan looks. But sometimes it's nice to just have it in a browser so you don't have to copy it all over the place. Also, sometimes it helps some folks like to see a visualization of a plan. I personally find it a little funny to look at a plan sideways. I keep wanting to rotate the screen when I look at this thing. But what this does is more visualization than anything. It's sizing the nodes based on a relative execution time on the parts of the plan. So these using the same queries above, these sequential scans are showing up as bigger circles than the amount of time it took to actually do the nested loop join at the top. But can be helpful looking at complicated plans to spot where the bigger nodes are, where query may be taking more time than you expected them to be. So how many folks write their own functions or stored procedures for Postgres? Any of you guys get into that? If you're familiar with pgAdmin, and I'm not aware of any of the other GUIs that do this, I'm not aware of any command line interface tools that let you debug stored procedures. Now, some of the caveats with this is that a stored procedure, stored function debugger currently only works with the PLPGSQL. So if you were writing your stored function with Python or Perl or even a C function, you can still always debug using GDB if you were so inclined. But being able to step through functions at breakpoints currently only works with stored functions using PGSQL. So the in order to do this, you do need to install an additional extension. And I imagine most people here are working on Linux and maybe to some extent Windows. But there are users of Postgres that are running it on something like AIX or Solaris even. And unfortunately, getting a debugger even for the PG SQL stored functions, this plugin still only works on if the database system is running on a Linux or Windows based system. So just to illustrate what some of these things, how a debugger can help, you'll have a pane up at the top that'll show what the code is in the stored function. And on the bottom pane, in this particular case, it's stopped at this line. And when you're at a breakpoint or whatnot, it'll show you the variables that are currently instantiated, declared. Tell you what kind of data type it is, and tell you what the current value is of what those variables are. There is another pane that you can also look at the statistics, and if you notice that there are line numbers in addition to, it'll number the lines for you, show you of the number of the lines of code, assign numbers to the code, and it'll give you a chart of how much time was spent on each line. This particular example, the line 15, there is a contrived sleep call here for 1 second, corresponding to this 15 to taking 1.01 seconds. So just for illustrative purposes, this is a really simple function, just to show some lines of code that they're numbered, and show you how it might look with these graphs. So you find a line of code that's taking unexpected amount of time to execute. Hopefully it'll show up easily enough in the line chart with the various spikes. So that was the short intro, or the brief intro to OmniDB. What I was hoping to show then at this point was more the monitoring stuff, which hopefully makes it stand out from some of the other GUIs. Because, you know, as you might expect, basic graphical user interface, how to let you put in queries or get some of the basic information and traverse some of that. So what I have here is a database with PGBench installed. Are folks familiar with PGBench? It's a little tool to put a transactional load on the database. So what I'm hopefully doing behind the scenes here is, yeah, that's better. I'm gonna do something a little more extreme. Okay. So I've started a little load. Oh no. Too extreme, sorry. Okay. So I started to load. I didn't realize it was going to reset the starting time here. But we're looking at the back ends. And this green line should be matching up with this green color here, my little PG Bench database where I just started 80 connections to connect to the database. So right now, this is set to refresh every 5 seconds.
That's showing the users as section the connections.
Yeah, so I think what this is doing behind the scenes is that it's counting the number of rows in the PG stat activity table.
So I use like Erlang's MQTT broker to plug it in. I would see that. I can then track stuff being stuffed into the database through MQTT.
Yeah. Yeah, and one thing I didn't go into detail. I'm a little inexperienced on this part, but some of these things are canned that you can monitor, and some of these things, and you can create your own things to monitor. So while this is counting all connections, what you could do if you think it's worthwhile is create a similar chart to only count connections, for example, using a particular user, or if you're familiar with the application name column in that table, if you know your applications are actually making use of that, you can also create additional charts just to watch.
And they don't have to go through OmniDB, they can go directly to Postgres?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is not something...
So you're reading tables in Postgres, not...
Right. This is not brokering, actually, in the middle of brokering connections for you.
The database size one was one I showed previously, and this is not going to be very interesting to look at in a live row. One of the other things that, or in a live... active data, PG Bench database anyway, is not going to grow megabytes in a few seconds. You can have a view to look at your, keep track of what your biggest tables are. So well, this updates every 15 seconds, and this database also only has 4 tables in it, but this will just refresh with whatever happens to be the 5 largest tables at that time if you need to keep track of whether your tables are growing. Oh, I guess, I wonder what this one is, the PG Bench history? Oh, okay. So I am somewhat familiar with this. Whatever this data was in here was from a previous test I ran. When I started another PG Bench run, part of the steps that PG Bench does is it clears the history table prior to whatever run is about to start. And I guess this one is starting to grow as I'm letting this test continue to run. You can also do something different than on my chart.
This one is just showing, I think just because it fits on the screen, what the first 10 rows that are coming out of the PG Stat activity database. And you might be able to see from the bars here.
Well, I can scroll back and forth. So while this particular canned example is showing the entire PG Stat activity database, you can create your own queries to show whatever data you want that you don't necessarily feel makes sense to be represented as a line chart or a bar chart, pie chart. This is similar to the number of connections shown at first, but instead it's representing the data as a pie chart. And in this case, all 80 connections, well, 100% of all the connections are on average connected to PGA Bench at the moment. But Here's one on log activity, showing you the number of doing counts of the exclusive log, access shared log, the no exclusive, and so forth over time. So I am curious for those of you guys that have monitoring I think I might have said that a little funny. Do you guys or have monitoring systems in the house that you already use to set up for monitoring different aspects of Postgres? I know in some cases it's nice to have kind of everything in one place, so you don't have to remember, oh, I'm looking at this system, you know, looking at this monitoring application. So a lot of these things aren't necessarily things that you would only be able to use in OmniDB and vice versa. Sometimes it's nicer to be able to look at some basic things in one application rather than unless you already always had your monitoring stuff open. So the things I showed you thus far are the things that come out of the box with OmniDB. Many of these things are driven primarily with SQL queries that it will take and just start plotting the data that comes back. I think I mentioned earlier that you could also create charts to look at CPU utilization and whatnot, but something like that, OmniDB is not going through the database to pull that information. It's actually running a remote SSH command and pulling data from that. So while it's not canned for you, there are some examples that OmniDB provides. So there would be an example of how it's SSHing and running NPStat and pulling that data to create charts for CPU utilization. So, while not everything is canned for you, there are some facilities to help you put together your own charts. And that's what I had prepared. I think that 4:15 was the end time, and I know they're going to do a raffle, so I don't want to hold people up too much longer, but otherwise I'm happy to hang around a little bit if you wanted to see something.
So if you're doing PG backup, uh-huh, and you're replicating onto, have you looked at being able to track the traffic when you're replicating and adding that to OmniDB?
I think there's a couple ways to do that. One way would be to do queries against the. I'm going to try to see if this.
So I'm just thinking that would be an easy way to look and visually see how far you are in the process of syncing the two up.
Yeah, right. This is showing what I want. Yeah, that is a good question. I know that there are some. This wasn't showing what I was hoping it would show, but I don't think there are canned queries to show things like replication lag or you know, progress is made on where this system is in the transaction log versus where your other systems are, but knowing that there are things in, if you're familiar with that check Postgres script to calculate what replication lag.
You're using OmniDB as sort of a utility that gives you an oversight for monitoring and access to the database for admins, for the database admins. So
right.
And the other one I was looking at is the logs. I'm going, can you on the logs see who's creating, you know, most, which process or user is triggering the most number of locks.
Right. So the short answer is, yes, you could build a query to do that and have it.
So you're, because you're, I presume you're kind of also thinking about things that make it useful for.
Yeah.
So and another one is your business case. Do you, MongoDB is it entirely open source, free, or
yes? It's MIT licensed. So.
Okay. Are you local?
I'm in Portland.
Okay. I'm just kind of thinking because I've used other tools for looking at databases and stuff years ago in the past, and they're all command line.
Yeah.
And the things I'm going, okay, you know, graphical, I'd like to see this, and I'd like to catch data and see it this way because, you know, the time you're spending on in a step where you're doing a query actually becomes really, really useful.
Right.
You've got somebody doing a query that's just done wrong.
Right. So I think one nice thing about MongoDB is that, well, it might not necessarily can run for you, it certainly lets you create one that you may think is useful to have.
Do you guys set up a way to do plugins that people contribute to do that, or is there a forum where people can do contributions? I seem to be like that would be a neat way to extend what you're going to make it useful because I've got an idea I didn't see.
Yeah. That's a good point. So let's see. What I just wanted to show, well, hopefully, maybe not as quickly as I hope, but
OmniDB refers to these things as units, these units really are separate code modules, if you will. Yeah. They are things where you have to query, so yeah, create a new unit, and then you can paste in whatever query you wanted to share and whatnot. But I don't believe that there is a specific forum now that people are able to just say, hey, I found this useful, I wanted to share. There is the primary host, it's not the right term, the main repository is using GitHub, so
okay.
So certainly.
You can go feedback that way.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, because I can, let's see, my applications tend to be more engineering use of things for the data. Yeah, it's not the same as what a normal business might be using, which would be.
Right.
So I'm looking at things that might be cramming things up really fast and just kind of goes in a slow trickle on your queries.
Right.
So I would be looking at different type of things.
So my use case is I'm using Postgres with PostGIS to do GIS work, but typically that's just my set of databases to do that. Just because I can store data so great and query it so great, there's a lot of stuff. But getting other people where I work to support using Postgres because I'd like it to be a part of our public facing. I work for the state, so it'd be part of a public facing application. I need them comfortable. They don't want to learn anything new. They know Microsoft SQL Server. That's all they want to know. So having some kind of interface other than having to command line it all really helps.
Yeah.
This looks a little better than the PG admin so far. But the other key for us would be some kind of LDAP or Kerberos Active Directory kind of stuff.
For
this,
connecting to,
yeah, so they can connect to this and
right.
Authenticate who they are without making any effort, and they go straight to the database, passing their authentication along.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything like that set up?
That's a good question. I not sure, but I could certainly pass that along and see if that's something.
And I know it's a bit of a trick, because really Postgres runs best when you're thinking Linux. It really does, because it's running under the context of the users on that box. or whatever you want to set up. So that's really, they sometimes the SQL guys are like, well, it doesn't scale well. Well, yeah, it does. It's free. Just start breaking up breaking up what you're trying to do into different processes under different users if you want whatever. But in the Windows world, they expect that it's running under a service account or an Active Directory account of some kind, mm-hmm. and then they can authenticate that with a group or something like that. It makes it harder for them to wrap their head around when it doesn't. Yeah.
Right.
So Active Directory is essentially Microsoft's tuning of LDAP.
That's what I said at first. So, if you can do it through LDAP.
And on the server side, if you depending on what you do, you can either use LDAP, like Savoy was doing LDAP with Linux servers and they're doing things with Windows to Active Directory now. But you can also have servers authenticate to Active Directory. And on the Linux side, if you set up SOM before, you can have SOM before as a Active Directory domain controller that replicates off of the Windows Active Directory. So,
right.
If you wanted to try, there's a way to try that. You could actually set up that way